said that I know that there are many people in the tenants of the market who intend for that item, so we are dealing with that item first. But just so members are aware, I'm not then going to deal with item 8 on the agenda. In that order, I'm in fact going to deal with item 9 before item 8. Some of you may know, and I'll mention it a little later, but of course we've got new labour centres that have recently opened. There is an event taking place tomorrow which requires a lead officer, Ms. Pritchard, who's here, to have quite a bit of work to do on that item tonight and also tomorrow. I clearly don't want to think it's going to be a public who are here for the main item, but at the same time, I don't really want Ms. Pritchard to stay here later if she's got other things to do, so I'm taking her item after the item that we're doing with Nick, so she can go home and do simple work in the council to offer her own plans to be ready for tomorrow. Moving on to item 7 then. Before I introduce this item, if I can simply say this, of course, at our meeting on the 5th of June 2019, we had an item where we decided that we would ask officers to bring a report back to this committee. We have that report before us. And members, of course, are asked to note the contents of that report. One of the things that I mentioned at the last meeting was that if anyone wanted to email me or come and see me, they were free and able to do that. I won't name all of the individuals because people may not necessarily want their names to be mentioned in that sense. If they don't. But what I will say is, of course, that several people took up the opportunity to do that. And you did come to my ward surgery, which I know is normally for ward matters, but I was happy to see you there, and you, of course, were all happy to come to that venue. And I'm grateful that we had about an hour and a half together, actually, discussing various items that you wanted to raise. I can see, whilst I'm addressing you, that there are some people who have. There's a paper that they're holding up to say, these are my fears. Someone's standing in the way, in fact, I can't read one of them, loss of independence. If I can address that, perhaps, as far as my opening remarks are concerned. There is no loss of independence agenda that officers in this administration are seeking to push. As far as where you live is concerned, as far as your right to a free and independent life is possible within this borough, they are things that this committee hopes will always continue, and they are things that officers always have at the forefront of their mind when addressing these issues. As far as matters are concerned generally, it is right to say that in the manner in which the MCFS financial strategy was drafted, some people were somewhat concerned by the manner in which they interpreted the drafting of that document or the relevant part. I assured people who came to see me and made the assurance earlier on, and I say the same thing now, but when officers are assessing individuals, they will always look to assess all of their eligible needs. They will then look to find the best way in order to achieve those outcomes for the individual. As far as moving people from their home somewhere else is concerned, no one would move an individual from their home to somewhere else unless that was an agreed approach with that individual. So that is settled law. There has not been any change in policy to suggest that we would be moving people against their wishes. And I simply make it clear that if anyone understood the previous drafting to suggest that that may be a possibility, it is not a possibility. It was not intended to be a possibility.
Did you amend it?
And quite simply, we will continue to assess people appropriately in a dignified and proper way and we of course would then look to find the most effective and appropriate way to provide outcomes for them. But the assurance that many of you want, and I know that from having spoken to some of you, and also from this debate that some of you are holding up, I suppose is the fact that you want the assurance that you're not going to be moved against your will. I said categorically, whether the council would have wanted to do that or not, I stress that the council's ever wanted to do that, but even if the council did want to, it can't, because the law says it's not a possibility. So as far as the manner in which individuals may have misconstrued what the medium-term financial strategy of adoptions may suggest or leave open to suggestion, there is no policy, and there never has been any policy.
How would you say the money?
That's a separate question we'll answer that. But as far as the item is concerned that we're considering, there is no suggestion anyone will be moved against their will from their home into a setting that they do not want to be in. And I think if anyone's concerned about that, then of course you have that assurance. If we are looking at how services are provided, of course, money is one thing we always consider. When we consider aids and adaptations and other ways in which services are provided in modern day times, and we've got lots of people here with a social work background and other backgrounds where they understand how technologies help and how things have gone to some extent, finances are always considered, but not in relation to an individual's assessment, not in meeting their needs, in that sense of needs assessment, and certainly we would not be moving anyone from their home in circumstances where it would be against the law. I look to officers to give more specific examples of some of the things that the council does and some of the statistics and things like that that people may have an interest in being aware of. I'll leave that part to perhaps Ms. Wakeley or Mr. Nass.
Thank you. So item
7
is the response to a member's item, and it sets out how the council is working to deliver this MTFS plan and what the phrase means. At the beginning of the report, we highlight some of our independent living statistics. So the Liberal Government Association's assessment shows that Barnet Council has fourth lowest level of residential care use for people over 65 in England. That's out of the 152 councils who do social care. And we have the 15th lowest level of residential care admissions for people of working age, so 18 to 64 in England. You can see on page 10 of the report that 80.9%, that's nearly 20% off 100% of people with mental health problems that we support live independently, much better than London and similar boroughs. 78% of people with learning disabilities live independently, either in their own home or with their family. Again, more independence than other boroughs, London or England. And we stay committed to that. The concern that was raised was, would people be forced to go into residential care? And the answer to that is no. The report sets out how that...
Your support at home can't be afforded.
The report sets out at paragraph 2.14, the specific information requested, which was how many people have been placed differently as a result of this approach. Are we still giving people what's called high-cost care and support plans in the community? You can see that we still are, 11 people. If you also asked how many people were placed in residential or nursing care permanently since this MTF saving, that is 5 people aged 18 to 64 and 47 people over the age of 65 in the first 3 months of this year. That is exactly the same as last year for older people, and one person less than for working age people. The rest of the report talks about how we make sure that the choice of the person is at the centre of the process, and how the law requires us to make sure that we develop our care and support plans according to people's choices. And it also says what the council does if there might be some question about the person's ability to make their choices known, or a question about whether they might have the capacity to make a decision. That is at paragraph 2.16. The process we follow then is governed by the Mental Capacity Act. It's absolutely important that we treat everybody as having the capacity to make the decision. If there are any issues about people needing information in a certain way so that they can understand it and make that decision, the law says we have to do that. If we go through all those steps and the person can't say what they need,
accessible information standard.
Exactly, we do follow that, I promise you. Then there is the process under the law that can involve the court of protection and best interest decision. But those rights of choice are set in law and protected in law, and we follow the law. I think that's probably just drawing out some of the main points. I'm happy to take any questions.
We're not allowed to ask any.
Just not from the public?
Members can ask whatever questions they wish to in relation to the site. I'm not sure which hand came up first, but I did see Councillor Cooper first, so Councillor Cooper first and then Councillor Turner.
I have a few, Chair.
Well, my usual practice, Councillor Salvi won't know this, because it's the first time I've been here, but my usual practice, as you know, is for you to exhaust your questions and then for me to go to the next person rather than sort of keep coming back to you and everyone else. So, Councillor Patel can wait for a minute if you can go through what you've got, and then we'll go to her and see whether that has come up.
Thank you, Chair. Forgive me, this report isn't very clear in reading it. You've got some great stats. You're following the Care Act. You are assessing people as eligible when they're eligible. You're providing care and you're keeping people independent. The only line that seems to be slightly different is that you will be considering the full range of care options to meet eligible needs, e.g. residential care, rather than offering community-based placements by default. Now, assuming you were following the Care Act prior to this, you were doing that anyway, because you can't just offer one in terms of information and advice. You are, in theory, providing all the options available to someone anyway. So if someone were to try to say that you weren't following the Care Act now, you could argue that you weren't following it then. You weren't discussing residential placements alongside all the other options. So if this is the only change in what you were doing already, my question is, what looks different or is being done differently that will allow you to save the 45k savings? Because I don't understand, unless you are either looking at people that can't make capacity, that don't necessarily have people with power of attorney to act on their behalf, looking at moving towards placement for those people rather than community options, then again, would people that don't have capacity necessarily meet residential criteria, which is a lot lower than nursing, cases are being presented by professionals as to residential option first, or maybe you're saying, well, you could stay at home, but you won't have anybody at night, and there won't be anyone there in between those calls. So I'm just trying to ask, basically, how are you going to save the money, and what does this look like? Because there is nothing in this that tells me that, And I can't really picture it unless it's one option sounds better than the other option, and that's how you're going to be presenting it. You know you can't, if someone chooses not to go into residential, there's not really a great deal you can do about that. And your own stats say that since the 1st of April, adults over 65 is the same number of people, and actually in the younger age group, there's one less than your averages from last year. So it's not like there's a sudden increased demand. What does this look like? I just don't really understand.
Your comments concerned, again, you refer to the drafting to some extent in terms of what the interpretation of it could be in terms of whether the Care Act was previously complied with. It's clever, I understand why you're saying that, but of course, the practical answer to that, the realistic answer to that, because as officers wouldn't consider all officers as they are due to be now, as would be appropriate anyway. I suppose your main question then, quite simply, is that if you are not breaching legislation, doing what you do best, which we see by statistics that we do rather well, then how do you make a statement? Officers can address that.
So just on the savings, obviously this committee has a £6.1 million savings target for this financial year. And as the majority of the adult social care budget is spent on care, the savings are coming from that care budget. Like all the savings we put in the MTFS, they are developed and thought about. Their deliverability is always dependent on them, what actually happens in the year and the need, the people that come forward needing care and so on. So are the savings, both the savings about this line and also the savings about moving people out of residential care into supported living or their own homes, as you'll remember, there are a number of those in the MTFS. All of those are plans and best estimates based on the work we intend to do, but we can never guarantee them at the beginning of the year, and we track them throughout the year. So they're never set in stone at the beginning, because it will depend on how many people come forward and what their care and support needs are.
So,
in terms of what I would see as being different, I think that there were a cohort of people where, when the conversation around options of support was had, that conversation probably didn't give a lot of consideration to residential care. And I think that, as Dawn talked about earlier, our ethos, in line with the Care Act, is supporting people to be as independent as possible and to remain in their own homes. There are, though, for some people, residential or nursing care is the most appropriate type of care to meet their needs. And I think we need to be careful that we don't see it as a bad form of care. We've got some really excellent care homes in Barnet that provide really good service and that people want to be in.
Provided by whom?
So what I think is happening now is that when social workers are having those conversations about what the best type of support is to meet people's needs, they are fully exploring the range of options. And we've got even more options now as well, because this isn't the only thing that we're doing differently. So for example, we've got a new extra care facility specialising in support for people with dementia, where actually people who may well have gone into residential care previously have now got an alternative option of where they can live in their own apartment as part of a complex which has dedicated on-site support, which is tailored for people with dementia. So the work of the social worker is to look at all of those options, explore them properly with the individual and their family if they're involved in that support planning conversation, and determine what the best program support is for that.
I'm not convinced I've had an answer to the question.
No.
Where are the savings?
Where?
It's very risky. base savings on essentially what may or may not be client choice and numbers. I just wanted to look at some of the figures. The 11 people that have been supported with community-based care and support plans with a cost higher than residential care, what is your block residential care cost, by the way? If you're doing it on a block?
We have different prices for residential and nursing and linked to dementia. One of my colleagues will be able to give you the precise amounts. We also use the care funding calculator for supported living placements.
Anybody got the numbers to hand?
Yeah, minimum sustainable price.
The calculation here is not based on that minimum sustainable price, it's based on the average rate that's paid.
I mean, I think you've discussed other options like people living in supported living, etc. And you know that the funding is different, and if often people in flats they get housing benefit, it's different. But you haven't, that isn't what this report is based around. What you focused on in this report is that you're making the savings from the difference between care provided in the community and residential. This is specifically what this report talks about. So I just wanted to ask, the 11 people that have been supported with community-based care that have got higher than residential care costs, but I'm not sure that you've given us an average. Were they people that would have met the criteria and been accepted by a residential home in Barnet, or are their needs as such, when you're looking at, you know, nearly £1,500 per week for care package, that actually they would have needed a specialist terminal nursing home?
We would have to give you that information separately to this committee. I don't have a list of each 11 individual's eligible needs in front of me.
Okay, so I suppose essentially what I'm doing is questioning the basis on which you come to your figures and your differentials between your numbers. You can't tell us what an average residential price is. You can't tell us whether these people were actually nursing home eligible, and that's what you based some of your differentials on. It doesn't make any sense. You can't say how much a residential placement costs, even on average, so we don't know where it is you're looking to make the savings. You've clearly shown from your own stats that there hasn't been an increased demand for residential placement from clients themselves, and I just can't see how these savings are going to be made in actual practice. And also, you know, perhaps this is a conversation for another time, but I'd be interested to know whether you still maintain the same number of residential beds as you did last year, because I'm presuming that most, I'm making a big assumption here, but most care homes charge more than the Barnet average, and the number of beds that you're probably being offered on a block are reducing anyway. But it's just that this is what this report has focused on, and I really can't see how the savings are going to be made, and I think some of the maths and the way that this report has been written is poor, and I'm afraid it doesn't stand up to scrutiny.
Councillor Pima, I will Councillor Hart, you've got a fair weight. I say that respectfully, because Councillor Patel's next, then it's Councillor Edwards' next. Unless your point relates directly to what's been asked. Well, either it does or doesn't. Because if it does, I'll let you squeeze it now if that helps.
Okay. I'm very happy to change the order.
Alright, Councillor Aspel, yours relates to what's being asked, but perhaps they can be addressed in the same way.
No, it's very good, especially in the economy wise, and I'll have a comment on it there. It looks as if in the budget, the savings are to be made in integrated care, that's 92,000, and also in prevention services. I'm going to say something about that, but I'm just wondering if that's where the current savings are expected to be made.
That's fine. Councillor, if we can deal with item 8 when we get to item 8, and I know why you're asking, because it also relates to what we're discussing now, but we'll make sure that that's covered when we get to item 8.
The thing I was going to say, four officers respond to the points that Councillor Peebles made. One of the concerns in relation to why this report was brought here was really in relation to the legality, if you like, of whether or not people would be staying in their home or whether they would be asked to move in circumstances where they didn't want to. The report adequately reflects what the legal position is on that and addresses that concern. And we've heard that thoroughly already in relation to the Q&As earlier and also matters that we've discussed already. The question you're asking, really, as far as the money's concerned, perhaps relates more to the generalised merit. But I only say that quite simply or just generally, because the budget's already been set. The manner in which you're asking the question, it's almost as if we're considering whether to put this line as a savings line or not. The line's already been agreed. It's more a question of whether the implementation of what's in the budget is going to plan. And therefore, officers perhaps haven't addressed this report in that manner because that wasn't the intention that this report expresses. The main concern for this report's been addressed, that no one's being moved away from their home address. So if officers don't have all the information you require as far as budget is concerned, they will no doubt respond to you by email. But I do understand that there are some figures that officers do have, which they've just wrapped up for you over the past few minutes, which they might be able to introduce to the committee.
And so the average cost of privilege that we've used for this purpose differs depending on the cohort of individuals. So for older adults, the average is £617 per week. Whereas for older adults with dementia, it's £709. For adults with primary need around their mental health, younger adults, the average is £974. For adults with a physical or sensory impairment, the average is £1,026. And for adults with learning disabilities, the average is £1,457.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Councillor Peebles. Councillor Patel, you're next, and then Councillor Evans.
Yeah, I mean, I want to return really to this question about 404,000, which you say is set, given that it's in the budget in three by the council. There's some language in here which is, seems to be slightly more to say vague. It seems to suggest that the budget were savings. And should also get clear on it, because I don't think the issue as articulated by Vision Line was this point that everyone seems to be elaborating on, by the officers, which is around people being bored. I think the issue actually that it looks like there is a target, and the target has been agreed, so that is a very clear objective for the council to make £404,000 worth of savings. And as Councillor Cooper outlined, there's really only a range of different ways in which that can be made. And the maths kind of almost held it against me, that 424,000 is coming out of his budget, and that means that there will be people who are worse off. That they could be worse off without necessarily being taken out of the time and being bought there. But under policy last year or the year before that, they would have been in community. They would not be in residential care. And I think that's the key point, that there are people out there who would be worse off under this policy unless we actually make a decision to change it. And the way we make a decision to change it is by taking it to full council and saying that we want to reverse it.
Concerned
it's immaterial. This bar has many residents who are living longer, which is great. This bar has many younger people who perhaps didn't survive into adulthood who now are, which is great. Financially speaking, as far as this committee is concerned, that of course means we have a lot more people that we need to help, and we will help them. But of course, like any other area within this authority, we would have to consider how much we have available to us and how we use those resources to meet those needs. There is no suggestion that anyone's eligible needs will not be met in any savings line that you find across this portfolio as such, because if someone has needs and we need to meet them, we will meet them. Officers do that very well day in, day out, and I praise them for doing that. It is right to say that when there are savings lines, they pop up all over the place. It's nothing different, perhaps, about this savings line, if you turn it out over another savings line, so far as you have to find better ways of doing things, and also consider how changes are generally coming about in terms of what individuals require. But the question that needs to be asked, and has been asked, and will be asked again, and officers can perhaps provide exactly the same response as they have, because I think that adequate answer then is quite simply whether or not they think that the budget line that they set, or the line that you're referring to, wherever it is, you refer to any document in the council today, whether you refer to it in the past or presently today, can they be satisfied that those savings are savings that they can make on our behalf? That's the real question to ask. If they suggest that they're working towards that and they can do that, then of course we can consider those milestones going forward. But budget's always set up.
All you're saying here is that you're not going to support a reversal, which,
assurances that officers are continuing to meet all of those needs. We have two members, I believe, of the legal department present here today, and a governance officer, all of whom, to understand, are not suggesting that we're doing anything contrary to the law. We continue to work for our residents. I look to officers to see if they wish to add anything further, but we have to be realistic about the budget that we have as well, and meeting people's needs. People's needs come first. The budget, of course, we then work to in trying to meet those needs as best as we can, which we always will do. I look to officers if they wish to have anything further. I look to officers first.
I'd just like to ask a couple of questions, if I may, and then make a few comments at the end in relation to the report. But first of all, I'd like to say that the statistics on page 10, paragraph 2.3, speak for themselves, and it's quite clear that, you know, the
terms of the telecare, we can certainly seek to get you some comparative information, but it isn't in the at the national data set. So that's why we don't have a benchmark. But we can get you some, we can try and get some information from the PTR, what we know from the other councils as well. But when we give you a benchmark figure, it's because it's coming from the national data set. So we know it's robust, it's the same indicator, same method of collecting. So that's why there's not a comparison.
I'd now like to just make a few comments, really, if I may, which are, I think, probably more political than being addressed towards the officers. However, I will start with saying that I have every confidence that police officers, social workers, and MPs assess people for support from the council, that they do so in a professional manner and in a way which does take into account the presenting needs of the client and the family that presents before them. My instinct is that the problems start after that when they have to deal with the budget implications of assess needs. And so the report is quite cleverly written because I've thought about being not allowed to take into account resources when assessing needs and considering provision necessary, but ultimately the reality is you do have to take into account resources when it comes to provision. And after 8 or 9 years of austerity, and particularly being after that time, I will put on the it would not be a surprise to know that our social services is also struggling in that regard. And unlike the highway department, where you can stop perhaps the road resurfacing because you're running out of money, you can't stop delivering our social services. And it's my guess that the 6.5 million has been a terrible target will be under considerable stress if we're allowed to deliver. What's been said in the report, if situation, if people's needs over the next 6 months or 7 months begin to change. And so I also chair and say that the budget has been agreed. I was hoping that should circumstances require that we have to find out who the most things are, the needs of our residents, but that we would attempt to do so. So I think that the difficulty that the officers have got here is actually trying to square the circle of not having enough resources financially. I think they're doing their best, but so the concern that we have is a political issue and the political decisions that have been made in terms of the overall budget. And it's not surprising that we have so many people here in the public because we got it wrong in the presentation and in how this was presented was that residential care is going to be cheaper and therefore that's what we're going to do. I'm hearing something different in this report. Mr. Master spoke about how they approach it and hoping that this is what will happen, but it's understandable why there's so much anger out there. You know, people think that actually you're going to put people in residential care because it's going to save money. And I'm sure that the officers are asking what their objective is. Basically, I'm not sure about whether that's I can say the same